I'd like to talk to you about our efforts in the Duwamish Valley, focusing on bringing scientific evidence to policymaking, engaging the community, and for the longer-term goals of community health. This is an aerial view, sort of blocked by the light, but looking towards South Seattle, the mouth of the Duwamish River. The Duwamish River is part of an 86-mile-long river that that reaches down from the Cascade Crest. The area is heavily industrialized. The Duwamish Valley is Seattle's largest industrial district. There are residential communities within the industrial district and surrounding it. This is South Park here in the foreground. The residents of South Park live by the river and play by the river. The river is also the home, historic, and treaty guaranteed to three local tribes. Oh, magic. And including one of which, the Muckleshoot tribe, which operates a commercial salmon fishery. And just to let you know, it's okay to eat the salmon from the river because they only spend a little bit of their life there. And they're usually not eating at that point. Most of the river, however, is unsafe. The resident fish and shellfish are unsafe to eat, even one. And there are advisory signs in multiple languages up and down the river. Yet people continue to fish. So in 2001, the US EPA declared the Lower Duwamish Waterway a Superfund site, one of the most contaminated sites in the country after decades of urban and industrial pollution. More than 10 years later, they came up with a proposed plan, and we decided to add information to the considerations about the proposed and selecting the final plan by conducting a health impact assessment. Now, just to give you some understanding about the river, because it becomes important, is that the Superfund site is 5.5 miles long. You can see the small areas marked in blue. Those are sites of early actions, early cleanups that have already occurred. Those in total will remove about half of the health risk. The chemicals are associated with about half of the health risk. The extended cleanup that's projected to start in the next couple of years and to take 7 plus 10 years to complete is estimated to remove another 40%, but still leaving 10% of the risk. It will still be unsafe to eat fish and shellfish out of the river, other than occasionally. So EPA plans to rely on what they call institutional controls, which are largely social controls, which are information and advisories, don't eat the fish. With our health impact assessment, we wanted to look at what would be the unanticipated consequences of the cleanup. Knowing that it's intended to be helpful, are there unhelpful things that we could anticipate and plan around? We focused on four vulnerable populations: community residents, subsistence fishers, the affected tribes, and workers in local industry. Now, a health impact assessment simply is a systematic approach to collecting and evaluating information so that you can generate evidence-based and health-informed recommendations for decision makers. It's usually focused on a proposed policy or activity or program. It has six conventional stages, but more importantly, it has a set of guiding principles, particularly democratic engagement of the stakeholders, equity, attention to equity in the assessment, sustainability, ethics, and then most importantly, taking a broad approach to health, looking beyond cancer. I'm not going to talk about this part of it. I'll put it up just to let you know we did look at short and long-term effects, such as effects related to the construction and things like gentrification, job creation, and job loss. We spent most of what I'm going to describe relates to what EPA focused on, which is the contaminated river sediment, contaminated fish. If you eat the fish, what is your risk of getting cancer? We looked more at these other domains. So for example, with non-tribal fishers, we address questions like who is currently fishing, why are they fishing, and what is the likelihood that they would or would not experience effects related to chemical exposure, changes in food and nutritional security, and social changes. We used a variety of existing information. The most important resource, though, was our graduate student who did most of the work, and the heavy reliance on community advisors and focus groups. This I just put up, and I obscure the fine points because I want you to know it's quite a challenge to distill all this information, because when we're not doing risk assessments, you don't end up with numbers you can add and multiply together. You end up with apples and oranges. We had a very systematic process to put this together, and to come up with recommendations, such as, for the fishers, one is that institutional controls need to go beyond just restrictions and information. They need to emphasize positive alternatives. It's not enough to tell people not to fish. It's more to tell them what they should do. There is a need for out-of-the-box thinking, and we gave some ideas, and that it needs to be culturally appropriate and sensitive, and that the evidence supports approaches that we describe for them. We put this together in a package of recommendations, separated out for different parts of different decision-making bodies, and this is where we are now. I'll leave this as a teaser as I close. These are the kinds of things you might say, so what happens next, and what kinds of things are we working on now? That's it. So, thank you very much.